No Church of God.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas. Is it too soon to say it? Everybody got their shopping done? Yeah. No? You still got time, right? Still a week. All the deals might be gone, but you got a week. You procrastinators. One thing about the shopping thing and so forth. We had our family Christmas last night, so. And Nolan was opening. He opened his first gift. It was a Tonka truck, and he was set, so, but he still had like 100 gifts to go still. When you think he just needed that one, and he was, you know, we didn't have to keep going. So when we think about that, you know, we receive so many gifts around this time of year, but that one gift that we have of Jesus Christ is really all we really really need. If you'll stand, let's praise Him. We're going to start with God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen.
Cold winter's night that was so deep. No.
Seated.
Good morning. It's great to see you all here in God's house this morning, and Merry Christmas. And also, we say the same greeting to those who are joining us online this morning as well. Just a couple of announcements. Today, after the end of our service, we're having our Christmas giveaway drawing, and if you haven't put your name out there in one of the buckets, make sure you do so. You have to enter your name in order to be eligible. There is no cost, it's all free, so make sure you get your name in there. Also, today, after Sunday school, we're going to leave as soon as we can, and we're going to be going over to our sister church, a Troy View Church of God, where Aubrey is going to be baptized. And so we just ask you to come and join us for that. And the Troy View Church of God is, you just kind of get the know where it's at if you haven't been there. It's next to El Sombrero on 25A there in Troy. So please come out and join us for that baptism. And at this time, I'd like to, also, if you didn't get a bulletin when you first came in, we didn't know where they had been placed. So we did find them, so there's some out there. So we do have bulletins today. And at this time, I'd like to read to you from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 11. And it says, "Then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and strength, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord, and he will not judge by what his eyes see, nor make decisions by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he will judge the poor and decide with fairness for the afflicted of the earth. And he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked." At this time, if our deacons will come forward, we'll receive our morning offering. Shall we pray together? Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day, and thank you for all your blessings that you send down to us all the time. We thank you for our families and those who are so dear to us, and for this time that we can be gathered together as brothers and sisters in Christ to raise praise to you, to give you thanks this day. And Father, we thank you for the hope that you've given us in Jesus Christ. And Father, we just dedicate these tithes and offerings to you this day. We pray that you would bless the giver, and Father, that these tithes and offerings would be used for your glory in this world. I ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Told me power up a bum bum. Our newborn king to see power up a bum bum. Our finest gifts we bring power up a bum bum. To that's fit to give our King.
If you'll stand and sing this with us, child is this. I think it's a record year that you see the amount of people out there. Actually, the delivery people. I don't know about you, but you can't go down some roads without seeing an Amazon driver, UPS driver, a FedEx driver, or somebody in their car delivering presents, right? I mean, there's just so much of it going on. So much of that, those people giving out there. And if you think about it, I think Jesus called us to do that in the end of Matthew. He called us all to be going out there, preaching his word and stuff, being just like those delivery people and taking the word out to the people. So Let us praise him. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for sending us your Son, because we know he will bring us goodness and light. And he's also brought us everlasting life. And that's all made possible, Father God, when we give our life over to you. And Lord, we thank you for the soul that will be entered, that's entered into your book of life today. And Lord, may there be more and more that we could bring into your book of life. You call us to go out and preach your word and find new people that will know the truth about you, Lord, and accept you into their life. Father God, I thank you for all the blessings you pour upon us. They are overwhelming and overflowing, whether we see it or not. May we take homage of it and give you thanks. We thank you all for all this, as we pray this in Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, thank you so much to our worship team this morning. Nice to sing some of those Christmas carols again, and just thank them for leading us in that music. And today, just a quick announcement: we're going to postpone our regular communion observance till next Sunday. So this is usually the Sunday we do that, but we're going to postpone that. At this time, let's dismiss our junior church and let them head on out. And as they head out, I invite you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Luke once again, and chapter 1 and verse 26. The book of Luke, chapter 1 and verse 26. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. It reads this way. It says, "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the descendants of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And coming in, he said to her, 'Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was very perplexed at this statement and kept pondering what kind of salutation or greeting this must be. And the angel said to her, he said, 'Don't be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end.' Mary said to the angel, 'How can this be, since I am a virgin?' The angel answered and said to her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. And behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age, and she who is called barren is now in her sixth month. For nothing will be impossible with God.' And Mary said, 'Behold, the bondslave of the Lord, may it be done to me according to your word.' And the angel departed from her." Let's pray before we continue. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this day that you've blessed us with, for this time you've blessed us with, and for your word that describes our hope, and also, Lord, describes your working in this world to save the human race. And Father, I just pray as we can ponder these things that we may understand them, that we may be grateful, that we may, Lord, just seek you out even more. Father, I just pray now that you would cleanse me, make me a worthy vessel to proclaim your word this day. I ask these things in the name of the Savior Jesus. Amen. You know, in our Bible story last week, it was also the angel Gabriel who appeared to Zechariah in the temple. And if you remember, he told this aged man that he was about to become a father for the first time. John was to be the name of his son. Later we know him as John the Baptist. And he would prepare the way for the arrival of the Lord, the arrival of Jesus. In our text today, the angel Gabriel, in the same fashion, only 6 months later, appears to Mary quite unexpectedly. The name of the angel Gabriel appears only 4 times in the Bible. Are you surprised by that? Only 4 times in the Bible is the name of the angel Gabriel does it appear. Twice it appears in the book of Luke, as we have here, And twice it appears in the book of Daniel. So there must be some sort of connection then between Daniel, the book of Daniel, and the book of Luke. When Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, appeared to Daniel, he told Daniel about the coming Messiah. And that was about 500 years before the events we're reading about here. Gabriel was also the one who told Mary that she was destined to be the mother of the Messiah. It's ironic that this announcement was made to a young girl. This grand announcement about the coming of the Messiah was made to a young girl in a very unimportant little village called Nazareth. Because as I have said before, big things often start in a very small way. Now Mary's son would be named Jesus, and he would fulfill all the hopes and all the aspirations of her people. He would also fulfill all the words of the prophets who spoke long ago. Her son would be the Savior of the world. And Gabriel proclaimed to Mary, says, "He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob," or Israel, "forever. And his kingdom will have no end." You know, even though Mary and her family lived in humble circumstances, she was a direct descendant of King David. And also her fiancé, Joseph, was a descendant of King David. They're in that family. And that the Messiah would be a descendant of King David was really an essential part of the promise that was made so long ago by God. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, King David, a thousand years before, had been promised by God that one of his descendants would sit on his throne forever. And according to 2 Samuel chapter 7, the coming king, the Messiah, would not only be the son of David, but he would also be the Son of God. And this is a promise made by God to both David and really to all of Israel. For this reason, the people of God long for the day when the Messiah would finally appear. But you know, by the time of the New Testament, as we're reading here, many years had passed since this promise had been made by God. And the hope of a Savior seemed distant and unattainable, for the kings of David's line no longer ruled on the throne. They long ago had been replaced by foreigners. And King Herod, you've heard of King Herod, he was one of those foreigners. The hope of the Messiah seemed so distant and so impossible. Yet as Gabriel announced, the time had come for the Messiah to be born. When it was most impossible, it's then that God seems to work. That Mary was a virgin is important and also essential to the story here. It's very probable that Mary was a teenager at the time, yet that she was a virgin says volumes about her character and about her faithfulness. The angel said to her, he says, "You found favor with God." You know, in the age of this age of promiscuity that we live in, we've forgotten about the value of chastity and faithfulness. You know, we have to remember that we're the product of the decisions that we make, and there's great treasure to be found in making those good decisions and making those strong commitments. For this reason, we can find strength in the example of Mary. Mary was a woman of faith, and for that reason, she was not afraid to ask questions of the angel. She was going to conceive and give birth to a son, and she asked, he says, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" This is a fair question to ask under the circumstances, for these were extraordinary circumstances. These were, you might say, impossible circumstances. How can a virgin give birth? How can this be? How are we to understand? The Bible here actually provides a set of lenses for us to view this very unique event and to understand it. We're given a kind of a context here, and I'll describe what that is in a moment. For example, Gabriel said to Mary in verse 36, he says, "Behold, your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age, and she who was called barren is now in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." So Mary's aged and barren relative, we think it was a cousin, was going to have a baby. Well, how could that be? Well, the angel notes, he says, nothing is impossible with God. You know, earlier in the book of Luke, we talked about this last week, Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, had also appeared to Zechariah, the husband of Mary's relative Elizabeth. Zechariah and Elizabeth were advanced in years and childless. The angel told Zechariah that he was going to be a father. And Zechariah kind of doubted this. He thought it was impossible. Even though Zechariah is a man of faith, when faced with an impossible thing like that, he kind of doubted that. Yet God seems to work best when things are the most impossible. And these two elderly people became parents of John the Baptist. It was an impossible conception, an impossible birth, but it happened. Now, if you think about it, you'll recall that there are actually several examples in the Bible of impossible conceptions and births. The foremost of those, if you look about the Old Testament, is that of Abraham and his wife Sarah. They too were advanced in years and long past childbearing age. Yet God promised that Abraham and Sarah would have a son. In Genesis 18:14, an angel came and made an announcement to Sarah that she would have a son. And it said that Sarah laughed to herself about it. And the angel reminded Sarah, nothing is impossible with God. Or it said sometimes translated, nothing's too difficult for God. Don't you know that? I find it interesting that these are the very same words that were spoken to Mary. Nothing is impossible to God. Nothing's too difficult for God. And the Bible here is making an obvious link for us that we might understand the nature of the virgin birth. Now, Abraham and Sarah were both ancestors of all the children of Israel. And you could even make the case that the nation of Israel existed only because God had made the impossible possible. In their old age, Abraham and Sarah became the parents of a son, Isaac, who was a child of promise. He was a child of promise. And the name Isaac means laughter. And laughter is the laughter of joy, but it's also the laughter of the impossible becoming impossible becoming possible. The child Isaac was a child of promise. God had intervened. God suspended the usual laws of nature. There are other, if you look in the scriptures, actually other examples of the same sort of thing where God made the impossible possible. In fact, Rebekah, the wife of Isaac in the Old Testament, was at one time barren, unable to have children. Isaac prayed to God for his wife, and she gave birth to twins, Esau and Jacob, who later became known as Israel. The mother of Samson was also without children, but God made the impossible possible. In the book of 1 Samuel, there's a woman there by the name of Hannah who was unable to have children, but she prayed to God for a son, and she gave birth to a son, the prophet Samuel. So the scriptures provide a lens through which we can view this very unique event, the virgin birth. In the same fashion as found in earlier stories from the Bible, God is about making the impossible possible. In the case of Mary, the power of God goes beyond anything that had been seen before. A child would be born of the most impossible circumstances. A virgin would conceive and bear a child. How is it that Mary was able to conceive? You know, she even asked this in Luke chapter 1, verse 34. She says, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" And Gabriel explained to her, and also indirectly to us as well, as we're kind of listening in. It says, "The angel answered and said to her," it says, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God." Now, what we have here is not God merely taking the place of a man in the conception of Jesus. Something else is being described here, I believe. I want you to notice these words. It says, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you." For some Bible scholars, those words seem to have a parallel to the act of creation, the act of the original creation found in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. And those words read this. It says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep." And it says, the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters, overshadowing the surface of the waters. So the Spirit of God is God's creative activity, God's creative power, and that God's same creative power that was working on the day of creation created a child within Mary. For this reason, it says here, the child will be called the Son of God. There's another interesting parallel with God's original act of creation here. According to Luke 3:38, you know, we know that Jesus is the Son of God, but according to Luke 3:38, it says that Adam, the first man created, was also the Son of God. Adam was a direct creation of God. Genesis 2:7 says of Adam, says this, "The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life." That word there where it says breath, that's the Hebrew word for spirit. God breathed into Adam his spirit, and it says he became a living being or a living soul. Adam was created from nothing by an act of God himself, just as Jesus was created by an act of God himself. Jesus existed not because of the will of man, but because of the creative activity, the creative act of God. And God made the impossible possible. Last week, I quoted to you from the book of Romans, Romans chapter 4, verse 17. And it says, "Even God, who gives the dead life and calls into being that which does not exist." God calls into being that which did not exist. There's a poll that I ran across. It's a few years old, but it was 2018, not that long ago. A poll revealed that 66% of Americans believe in the virgin birth of Jesus. 66% of Americans believe that. And if you think about that, 66%, that seems kind of low, doesn't it? It seems kind of low. In fact, those numbers are actually down from 2014. In 2014, 73% of Americans believed in the virgin birth. Why such a change over just a few years? And I wonder if that poll was done today, what the response would be. And my question is, why are people losing faith? Let's face it, the virgin birth is an impossibility when regarded in light of our own reason and experience. It's something that is impossible. In fact, a great deal that we've talked about today goes beyond our actual experience. and observation. And many of the statements I've made today are statements about faith. In any other context, we might regard all this with a suspicious eye. So you think about it, there's this angel that appears to a young woman. There's a promise made to King David, who lived over 3,000 years ago. There's a talk about a Messiah who will reign forever and ever, whose kingdom will have no end. There's a virgin who will conceive and give birth. You know, all this, and from a certain perspective, seems quite impossible. Yet in all this, we find, I think, the true essence of faith and hope. We choose to believe. We choose to trust. We choose to have hope. We believe in a God who makes the impossible possible. Can I get an amen? We believe in a God who gives the dead life again. We believe in a God who calls into existence that which did not exist. And we talk about Christmas and all the things that we're celebrating. We must remember that Christmas makes us remember that God is not limited, that God makes the impossible possible. Christmas gives us the confidence, once again, that God is indeed working among us. He's still making the impossible possible. So this time of year, I just pray that you may see God at work and you might see His glory in the birth of Jesus Christ, our Savior. At this time, I'd like to ask our worship team to come on back up and lead us in a closing song.
You guys, like, stand with us. We're going to sing "When I Think Upon Christmas."
Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we come again to this time of year as we just celebrate and we rejoice that the Savior has been born. And Father, we pray this day that we may trust in Him. And Father, we pray that Your Son would soon return to this earth, bringing Your kingdom, bringing righteousness and peace and life to this tired old world. But Father, we just pray that You give us that sense of hope and sense of peace today. I pray for each person here. I pray that You would send them away with a blessing. Also, I pray for those who are joining us at home as well, that You would watch over them this day. I just ask these things in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen.